4, 3.
We'll do it live!
Now we're live! Aaron Kennedy, the general craziness of it, the impact on your life.
We have gone through so many stories and we said, you know what? This should not be kept to the two of us. Mekin, and you know what you're doing, please.
Do you know how many times that happened to me in real life, though, where I'm like,
many.
JK,
it's important.
Sorry, guys.
To be
sorry,
hydrated.
Everyone. Do it again, Erin.
How are you, Mekin?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm good. I am super excited because we have our first guest waiting in the wings, who we will introduce very shortly, one of our most favorite human beings, and we're so glad that he's here with us.
I love this person. Just the spirit, the understanding of life, the what he can share. I think you're going to love it.
Yeah. And besides, he's also one of the few people who's kind of still in the business. Mm-hmm. So it'll be fun to talk to him there. He has disappeared. So I don't know that I should pull his camera up yet. Talk about doing this live. That being said, this is pre-recorded. We wanted to thank everybody for watching Broken News. We are so grateful for all of our new subscribers, likes, and comments. And so we are going to start this conversation, and we have lots of questions for him.
Yeah, we have lots of questions for everybody. And you know what? It's interesting because those same questions, everyone's going to have a different answer. But when you add it all up, it all adds up to the crazy business that we were in for so long. And in the case of our guest today, still in the business. So we'll understand a little bit more about what he's doing now,
yeah,
why he made the choices to work the shifts he's working now. All that stuff is super important to understand.
All right. So drum roll from one of our very close friends from Chicago. Mm-hmm. Wonderful human being. Lovely to have him on. Lionel Moise. Welcome, Lionel.
This is like old times.
It's
I have
good
not
times.
Seen
it is so good to see
you guys.
Isn't so it crazy?
So, Lionel, tell everybody where you are now, because I think people want to know where you ended up.
Yes. Well, I live between New York and Miami. I'm very much a pandemic worker. I work from home, and right now I am doing network radio. So I'm still in television. I've switched over to a different medium, but I still work the crazy hours, as you mentioned.
What are your hours?
I'm very tired right now. This week, during the week, I do the overnight shows. So I start around 9:30. My first show's at 11:30, and I do that until 4:30 in the morning. And then I pray that I fall asleep, and I don't. I usually get back up at 10 a.m. I went running. I'm talking to you guys, and I'm going to pray that I take a nap after this as well.
It's so
you're just
hard
adding all the sleep up.
Yeah, I think, I don't know about you guys, but I feel like one of the top three questions I always got was, when do you sleep? So Lionel, when do you sleep?
I was doing really good before and sleeping straight. So when I worked the morning show, I used to sleep in like shifts, like two naps, but I'm back to napping again. So I sleep like 4 hours right when I get off. I get up, make breakfast or have dinner, try to do something normal. And then I go back to sleep for like another 3 hours. But my schedule is like changing every day. So sometimes I'm sleeping in the middle of the day. Sometimes I'm sleeping in the middle of the night. It's just a mess.
This is how I developed insomnia.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And how many stories have you done about that? Mm-hmm. About how unhealthy it is?
It's weird. They do always talk about how good coffee is for your health. So that is one benefit since I'm drinking so much. But it's always like lack of sleep is linked to basically every cause of death. And so I have been trying to find every way. I count sheep. I sleep with an eye mask. I keep my bedroom in my house very cold. Earplugs. Sometimes. Just a mess. But I will sneak a nap wherever I can.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we are so glad you're here, Lionel. I mean, we love you so much. It's been wonderful to kind of watch your progress and journey after leaving Chicago. I think it's really interesting that you're still in the business. And so we're kind of making our loosey-goosey theme for the show, telling the stories of how we were fired. And then we were all like, I'm sorry, but you're going to have to be more specific as to which time, right?
Yes.
Every job, essentially, like you're on a contract, and they just kind of don't renew you at the end. So we call it being fired because they're choosing not to employ you anymore.
Yeah, but hold on. Aaron, how many times were you fired?
Every single job I had, every single job. I mean, I've had renewals, but every time I left, it's because I wasn't renewed.
Okay.
And that's like,
I had one Lone Ranger time, the biggie.
Good for you.
Yeah. Oh, well, that is good for you.
But I got lucky. That was lucky.
I thought the biggie was my only time, and it happened to me my next big job after that. But
so, yeah, go ahead, Lionel. I kind of touched on this during our last show because I felt like your TV goodbye was so emblematic of how people leave the industry under the cover of darkness, like you're a criminal, and we never see you again, except we did go out drinking that night, but we can talk about that later.
We did.
So go ahead, share your story.
I'm so good at and things that I had. Because there was just a lot of other things going on. But it's hard because you have to learn to not take it personal. And I tried not to take it personal at that time. But our business is so subjective. So one person's trash is another person's treasure. You might be the flavor of the day. You have to look at it just like you would look at an actor or a musician. Right. And we think that us as journalists, we're not in the show biz. Like, the lights go out sometimes and the curtain closes on you, and it unfortunately happened to me that day.
I'm glad you brought that up, because when I was speaking with my brother-in-law and my family after you were let go, I don't like the word fired. I said to him, I said, yeah, well, they got rid of Lionel. He's great. I don't know why. And he said, was he not meeting his deliverables? And I said, deliverables? This is TV news. They're good on deliverables. You know?
Yeah.
No, it's totally subjective. And the thing is, you know that all the time because you're constantly getting feedback from your bosses, which may be like, I didn't like your energy today. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, like this really vague feedback that is completely, you can't act on it, which is why, and how can you not take it personal? I've never managed to not.
No, it's, I was literally one time to be less Megan. Megan, can you be less Megan? And I was like,
I've been told to stop talking so much when my job is to talk as an anchor. They're like, you talk too much. Okay, well, I'm sorry you hired me to
talk.
You know, talk and ad lib into weather. Like, I'm sorry that I commented on the sun too much this morning. but it is so subjective. And the same way we watch television and we have people that we like and we're drawn to. So do our bosses. So do the viewers. You just have to kind of hope that you're always on the right end of that revolving door, because the door does move.
And I think what's hard too, I don't know if you guys have experienced this, but I always feel like I have survivor's guilt, right? When you leave, it's like you feel grateful that you weren't fired, and then you feel guilty because I love you, Lionel. And it's like, oh, thank God I wasn't fired, but Lionel was fired. Why do I? It's like, it's just so much emotion that goes into it. And that was why after it happened, you know, I was like, should I call him? Should I see if he wants to like hang out other than just dropping off his phone and his coffee maker? So I'm really glad that, you know, Lionel came over with like a bottle of bourbon with my family, and we just walked around and ate and had pie and dinner.
It was a really lovely day. And I wish we had done it under other circumstances. The other weird thing is like just feeling the energy. Something in my heart told me to call this agent that I had been speaking to for years. And I said, I think my contract is going to have a window coming up soon. I literally called her the day before it happened.
No.
And then, so the next day when this happened, I'm like, this can't be real. Like, all of it was just kind of, but I felt something, but it wasn't like, it would be better if we like were told you mispronounced a word, then you know, like, I cannot say this word, I'm going to get fired for it. But it's subjective. So it was hard. But as a 25, I was 25 at the time, I had worked, you know, to get to like this dream place. And I felt like, am I worthy? Like, do I suck that bad? Like, why would someone do this? But then you learn, like, this happens to all the greats.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And greater people have had this happen and moved on to even greater places after that. So you have to kind of learn to take it positively, as hard as positive as you can make being fired.
Mm-hmm. And I think like what people at home may not understand exactly is that in this business, when you're criticized, whether it's from viewers or management or whomever it is, you feel like it's you, because what they're criticizing is you.
It is you.
They're criticizing how you talk, how you look, what you said, how you said it. Instead of like in another job, if you do a bad job on a report, it's like, oh, they're criticizing my report. No, it's us. Mm-hmm. So it's hard.
Yeah.
Did you, Lionel, what's your experience then with kind of consultants? Did you ever get any like feedback where it was like, I don't even understand what this means, or this is offensive, or where are they coming from?
This is weird because I feel like now I get a lot more feedback in my career now, but I think I've just learned to like ask and force, like, boss, I need you to tell me, what did you think about this? Or even if they don't want to look at a script, I'm like, can you please look at this script? Like, let's work through this. Because I felt like in most of my career, I did not get much feedback negatively or positively. Positive feedback would have been in the ways of promotions or getting that new job, but I never was told like great delivery today or sucky delivery today. I never had a consultant tell me to change my clothing or my look. So I had nothing that I could like immediately point to when someone then says, well, that's not the flavor we want anymore, because how am I supposed to know this? Like, I feel like we're in the studio doing this job every day and we just get through and do it the next day, you know?
What did you feel like it was? Because I know all of us, when this happened, is like, oh, I got to figure out what I think was the cause. Did you even,
you know,
conclusion?
It's hard. Like, I was very depressed at that time already. Like, my father had just died. I was going through a very bad breakup and I was dealing with my HIV diagnosis. So honestly, like getting fired was like a relief. It was hard to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning and keep a smile on when you are struggling to be happy to wake up that day, you know, right. And you're getting up in the darkness and at this weird hour and talking about such terrible things happening in our community because of all of this breaking news that, you know, we don't dictate what is happening. These things are happening. And I felt a little relieved, which is weird. So I didn't really pay much attention to like, what did I do wrong at that time? It wasn't until it took me like another year or so to get another job that I'm like, wait a second, like, is this the end of my story? Like, am I no longer going to be a journalist? Does nobody else want to hire me? And like, what am I going to do with my life? Like, I switched from pre-med to get into journalism. I do not have any science background or interest to do that. Like, what is going to happen? But I've learned to not take it personal. Mm-hmm. And so if I had a business or a show and I had a direction or a vision that I wanted for said business or said show, it would be my liberty to do that. Mm-hmm. I just am happy that now in the industry, we are talking a lot more about these things. So that way people can be sure, or that we can hold people accountable to treat people with respect. Mm-hmm. And as long as you treat us with respect, it's okay to fire people. And so that's, you know, maybe I would have liked a little bit more feedback in times that I was not renewed, but I'm grateful for it because had that not happened, I would have not moved to New York unemployed. A friend then invited me to come live with him and kicked me out after 2 days. So then I'm like unemployed and homeless in New York City. And I showed up at my grandmother's door and ended up living with her for like a year and getting all of this love and like peace that I needed.
Right.
And so when the next job and opportunity came, I was like so ready and so happy. And I think it forced me to get a break that I needed. And so would I do it all again? Yes. And, you know, being fired is not always so bad, but in the future, I probably would have saved half my paycheck with any job. And I probably will do that moving forward just in case. One day.
Except for when your first paycheck is, what was your first paycheck, Lionel?
My first paycheck where?
First job.
Your first market. What was your very first salary?
Okay. So I will be honest. Mine was not the typical starting job. My first salary was $45,000. Because I got lucky that I did a talent development program with Gannett, which was amazing to me. And they placed us regionally. And because I was in the Southeast, they just happened to place me in Atlanta, which I pushed for. And because it was such a big market, even as a producer starting, I started off making a lot more than I should have, which was harder because then my next job, I basically got no promotion or raise. I went on to then become a morning anchor and make the same amount of money.
Right.
But I didn't have the $18,000 a year starting off salary that many of my lovely colleagues have had. And people don't get that either. Like, you have to call your mom to pay your bills. And
yeah, you do.
People think that you're driving a Range Rover when you're in, you know, Oklahoma starting your first job. And it's just not going to be the case.
No, and we should probably even do a whole salary episode.
Absolutely.
TV is not what it was. I mean, there was a day when people were sitting on the desk and making millions.
That might not exist anymore.
Yeah. As my agent always said, flat is the new raise. But beyond that, they keep asking people to take pay cuts. Mm-hmm. I don't want to diverge though. Sorry, Megan, am I interrupting you?
Yeah, I was just going to say that's exactly right. That's what it's turned into. It's like, you're just supposed to be happy if you weren't let go. Mm-hmm. That's
the word.
Yes.
You were happy.
Yeah. You weren't let go.
Yep.
Lionel, I do want to take a moment though to say I was so happy, and I feel like I had this proud mama moment when you came out as HIV positive and that you are using your platform to be an advocate. And I just congratulate you. I think it's such a wonderful story to share. And I hopefully you'll share a bit of it with us right now. And I wonder if, you know, at least where you are right now, you get to share that story. I wonder if you would have been able to in your earlier career, you know?
Yeah, it's weird because I keep joking now when I talk about this last coming out, I'm like, how many times in my life am I going to have to come out? I had to come out gay, then I'm coming out as HIV positive. You know, I wasn't out on air when I first started in news. And so that was a big deal. I came out on air as gay in South Carolina as a gay Black man, where they had the Confederate flag flying on top of the state house. And that was a debate, and same-sex marriage was the debate. So even that alone was a lot. And so I don't think that I would have had the space or liberty or love to be able to come out at the time that I was diagnosed. And it did happen later on in life. But I'm grateful that at this point in my life that it has been received well, and that people are willing to have a conversation, because there are just so many things like the news business, also health, where we just think like, if we don't talk about it, it doesn't happen. And there are multiple people getting diagnosed every day, straight, gay, Black, white, across the range. And we just pretend like this is an old gay disease from the 80s. We watch a show like Pose and they touch on it and we're all touched. And then we move on like this was the past. And this is still affecting people. And I was an HIV advocate before I was diagnosed. So that in itself should show how much of an issue this is, because mm-hmm. I was advocating for people to know their status and to get tested. And I still was impacted by this virus that I was working to prevent. And so that alone shows that we have a long way to go. Mm-hmm. And I think the only way to do that is to speak about it. And I feel like as journalists, we're always expected to be like a robot with a little personality. So you don't want to know too much about us, and you can't know
that
there's a struggle,
or you can't have an opinion. And I get in a political sense, fine, you should never know political opinion and we have to be unbiased. But if we're talking about the Black experience, I cannot change it, I'm Black. If we're talking about motherhood, you cannot change it, you're moms. Okay. And you shouldn't have to hide that. Same with HIV and health. I think it's important. When we saw news anchors expressing their COVID experience on air as the rest of us were locked at home, freaking out about what was going on, that opened up our eyes to a real life experience that someone else was having. And I felt like by people being able to relate to me and me having this platform, if I hid something that I was going through and wasn't vocal about it, I would not be using my talents to their ability. Hmm. And so that was what pushed me to be more vocal about it. Also, we're like fighting for everyone else to be transparent and tell the truth in news. And I'm like, how can I be like living this lie, even though I don't think I'm forced to tell anyone any of my personal business? But right. I just felt like being fully open, I can fully be myself and hopefully fully make an impact.
Yeah. Well, we're proud of you about it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I think you alluded to it earlier, but at that time when we were all working together, all of this was happening for you and you were still managing to get up and put a smile on and move through your day.
It was hard.
It's not easy.
It was hard. Like we had little breaks in between the shows and stuff. And I'd literally be sitting in my dressing room in the dark, just like staring at the wall, waiting for the time to go by. But I don't want the time to go by too bad, because then I'm going to go home and I'm going to be home and be sad there too. Yep. You know, and so I just had to learn to keep pushing. Mm-hmm. But here we are.
Here we are. You know, this is the lamest way to say this, but I saw on like somebody's like Facebook gushy moments, when life kicks you, let it kick you forward. And that's kind of how I feel. Like, I feel like, you know, you got kind of a foot in the butt, but at least I feel like I'm in a better place now.
Yeah.
Megan and I talk about that all the time. The grass is greener.
Much greener.
And even those bosses, right, who you feel are making these difficult decisions and firing you, they are also in these same positions. And yeah. So it's
don't you dare humanize the bosses.
I'm not humanizing anyone specifically. I'm just saying, we everything is a machine. And the machine is going to spit people whatever way it wants, but you have to make sure that you're like aiming in the right direction and always moving forward.
And part of that is staying true to yourself. Yes. You have to. So you don't leave anything on the table. And you know, if you got fired, at least you went out being who you are and what you are. And you don't have to feel like you held back. And what if I would have been true to myself? No.
And no one can say that I was nasty or mean or ungrateful or conniving. I know that I was the best human I could be at that time, even if it wasn't the human that was needed for there or any place at that time. Mm-hmm. And I've learned that that goes with anything, with family, with relationships. Like, you can only do the best that you can do. And once you know that you've done that, like, you don't care what anyone else thinks. Same like when I came out as gay. Once my parents knew that I was gay, do you think I cared what anyone else said around me? Like, my mom already knows, like, there's nothing you can say that's going to hurt me or hurt my feelings. But as a kid in school, you don't know that when you're hiding this from your parents, what the kids say to you matters, And so I think being true to yourself is the basis of anything.
Yeah. Lionel, were you ever told to be less gay or hide anything in the business? And you don't have to say which station, what, where, but was that ever a thing?
There have been times where, like, I've been told like a certain tie is too floral to be wearing here, which is weird. Like, when now floral is in and all these straight men are wearing all these bold things, I'm like, it's just a tie. There was also a mentor who I thought was a mentor who critiqued my work and was like telling me that I needed to butch up on set. And I completely like,
did they use those words? Respect.
That is exactly what he told me. He was not in a hiring position. So it's not like a boss telling me this, but I was caught off guard because it's like, I would expect someone who had been in this business so long to be like their most authentic self. You know, when you see Oprah sit down, you don't feel like she's like becoming Oprah. She's just sitting down and having a conversation. She's herself. Mm-hmm. And for him to say that to me was like hurtful, disrespectful. And also like, I realized that he had it wrong and I ended up surpassing him in the business. Not that this is ever a competition, but I think that reinforced that being myself was the right way to be, because he was so worried about being someone else, and probably because he wasn't living his own truth. But like, how dare you say that to me? Like, it's just so weird. It's weird.
But if you're if you're trying to play somebody else on TV, you're never going to make those connections with the viewers that count.
Because we can feel it.
You surpassed him because you were who you are.
Yeah. Now, that being said, how many times do we have to fake it that we liked the person we were working with? And I mean,
that is hard,
but it happens. And it's not like a regular workplace where, like, I don't like Joe, but you don't have to work with Joe, but there might be people where you're working shoulder to shoulder and you do have to fake it.
That is the hardest part. And I think that is like very exhausting. And this is when people like see TV shows about TV and they see it go to commercial break and they like turn the other way. Like, I'm not talking to her, but that really happens. Like,
it's real.
People are personalities and sometimes it takes a while to warm up. I feel like I want to like everyone, but it takes me a little while to know if I can like trust you and how much to say to you. And so from that aspect I get, but there are also some people who like backstab you in the business and they get promoted with you to do this show or are filling in on this show. And you like, there were times where I felt like a fill-in was like trying to take my co-anchor's job. And so I'm like, am I going to be nice to this person because I'm like trying to be loyal to someone else, but this is still a work relationship. There's just a lot of nuances that go on behind the scenes. And most people just don't know about it. And most of us are just trying to focus on being good journalists and meteorologists and good humans. Yeah, so we're not really thinking about all this drama, even though we're like getting intertwined in all this drama that's happening around us.
And it's stressful though. Add that to like no sleep and the other stuff you don't know about and how am I doing, but you're not told. And then you have to worry about all these other little undercurrents that are happening all around you.
Like, and I always joked, like, I didn't want to call in sick and I didn't call in sick as much as I should have, even like when we worked together, because I'm like, if I call in sick too much, someone else is going to have my job. It's like, okay, like one day is fine, but you're going to take that week off and, you know, Joe is going to warm your seat and they might like Joe better than you.
And Joe will get better ratings.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, yep. No. I'm coming in. This is pre-COVID. So like, you know, after the first day of the cough, I'm like, I'm coming into work. Like, I'm not dealing with this.
Yeah. I was saying we should share the story, though, how it was shortly after you had started that we got an email from the bosses that said, we need you to come upstairs after the show. And we're thinking, okay, we are either all getting fired or this is some other big news. And what it was that they were switching seats on another show. And Lionel, you and I were taking over for two other people. And so then we were all walking down together and we felt guilty because those other people were just learning about it at the same time. And you have to make sure that they know that you weren't gunning for their job, that this was just part of the business.
They might not believe it anyway, even if
And then again, you have the survivor's guilt and
it is. It's like, you're getting this great opportunity, but you know that it impacts someone else. And every seat and every anchor in every show is filling a seat, right? So if they move on or they get fired or they get promoted, someone else comes behind them. So someone else gets an opportunity, but it might be at their expense.
Mm-hmm. And it almost always is. If you're coming in, most of the time it's because somebody's going out.
Yeah. And again, like as you get higher, it gets less likely that they're moving on to another job because there's less markets that you're moving up to. So once you get to like, let's say a network, unless they're going to another network, they might be leaving the business or... So that is a hard thing. And that is why I think I'm grateful for you guys. Like, I feel like you guys have always just been so kind and real to me. And we never felt like it was competition. So there was never any of that backstory when I was worried about what's happening to me or what happened to y'all. I knew that it wasn't anything that we were trying to do to hurt each other. I felt like we were all a team and protecting each other. And I think that's really how it should be. Let the other people deal with that kind of stuff. Like, if they're going to get rid of you, they're going to get rid of you. If they're going to promote you, they're going to promote you. Like, you can't really, it's just a lot. Like, I try to stay very far away from the workplace drama. I just want to like do the show and move on. Like, I don't have the time.
And take a nap. All right. We're going
to questions to ask Lionel.
Let's move into our, craziest place you've peed.
Okay, I'm not going to say which job this is, but I had to pee in a solo cup in my car reporting on breaking news in the field for like 13 hours. And fortunately, this family, they saw me like in my car all day and they like welcomed me into their house and gave me water and let me use their bathroom later on in the day. I couldn't even tell them that I had a full cup of urine in my car prior. Like, they saved my life. It's you know, sometimes you get sent to the scene and it could be something crazy. This was a really big story. And I was there all day, no bathroom in sight.
Right.
And all this coffee that you're drinking to stay awake and be able to do your job, it's coming through.
And no one's worried about where Lionel's going to the bathroom. They're like,
no, and they're not setting up porta potties at the crime scene. No, they're not doing that.
Craziest viewer letter or comment?
This was not a comment, but there was this viewer who would come, who would write me on Facebook when we were in Chicago. And do you remember someone would come moon us? Like, shortly after I get a message, there would be a butt in the window. And like that was weird. Like, that is weird, you guys.
In like the 4 o'clock hour.
Yes. Yeah. And I never understood why they like were so big on security with us and always let us know, like, if you feel unsafe, we will walk you to your car. We will, like, they had us park in the building. Like, because weird things like that would happen. Like, do not tell me that you're coming to see me and I don't want to see that side of you.
And just to make sure everybody understands, we had a Windows studio. So on two sides, as you're broadcasting live, you have people's, you know, what's in your faces.
Booties.
So, booty.
As we're trying to keep a straight face.
Yeah, doesn't happen. All right, most dangerous assignment.
There was a time when I worked in Atlanta, I was an MMJ. I was sent like in rural Georgia to do some story. And we were like kind of walking through this neighborhood, and you'll understand why this matters more now. But I like went through this back alley and I started seeing like all these Confederate flags. And like, I just felt completely unsafe. And this was like a new job, first time in the business. And I'm like, am I really about to call them? And I called them and I was like, I'm leaving. Like, this does not seem safe. And you know, as we move forward and see stories that have happened, people just existing, walking in neighborhoods, I was like, I don't want to be that guy. And I couldn't follow the other journalists who felt the liberty to walk through these neighborhoods. I didn't feel safe. I felt like it was very dangerous. I wouldn't do it again.
And MMJ, for anybody who doesn't know what that is, like, Lionel was doing it all himself. He's the photographer, the producer, the reporter. So he didn't have a crew. Like, you were by
there was
himself.
No one there with me to be a witness or safety. I am very bad with directions, so I had no clue where I was. It was pitch black. And like, I'm from South Florida, but it's not the real South in the same way that I learned when I moved to South Carolina and Georgia. Like, you know, there is racism everywhere, but it was more personified in that part of town that I was in. And yeah. I learned very quickly how I was viewed by a lot of people working in that market. So
well, I'm glad you at least felt comfortable saying no. Tell me you worked in TV news without telling me you worked in TV news.
I say stand by for everything. Like, it's ridiculous. My mom is like, tell my boyfriend, do you want breakfast? Stand by. Or my mom's like, can you do this? Stand by. I'm coming. Stand by. It's like, okay. There's another word that you can use, like, I'll be right there. But standby is kind of fun to say too. Yeah, exactly. So
it's quicker to come out. I think that's why I said it that way. All right. Longest time on air.
Like consecutively?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or like, do you mean like years worked or like hours?
Oh, no, we meant like one like on breaking news.
Live, yeah, during a breaking
I would
news.
Say probably the Surfside building collapse. I was working radio then, so it was a little different because you're like calling in, but we were doing live coverage, like, I don't know, it might have been like 6 or 7 hours, and then in between they have us do two ways, so you're calling in to all of the local affiliates. So if we weren't live like on air, then every like waking second I had in between, I'm like calling into a radio station doing a 2-minute hit. I have never like talked that long or been out in the field that long without food or water ever in my career. And obviously like a difficult story because it was like my community, you know, South Florida, but I never imagined that I would have been on air that long.
Mm-hmm. Then we're adding this one. What was a skill that you learned on TV that is like kind of a life hack that we can teach everybody at home?
There are more than enough hours in the day. And so I am dealing with this like motivation factor now. Like sometimes like in TV, we just learn that we like have to get up and go to work. Everyone else is like, there's no way I could get up at 1 o'clock and go to work. And so we just learn like this discipline of like, you need to get it done. This is your career. This is what you want to do. Like, you're just going to have to get up. It sucks. Even if you went to bed at 10 o'clock, even if the kids are screaming, you're going to get up. And I've had to learn to use that mentality in like everything else in life, because now that I do have crazy hours, but it's not as crazy and rigorous as it was before. And I'm always like, I could do that later, or, oh, but I should sleep first. And it's like, no, like you can do it. Like there's no excuse why. Coffee will solve everything.
Yeah,
or for tea for Megan, some green tea or matcha.
You. I don't have it today. I should have had it for you.
Yeah, I've just learned like, you can get it done. And so like we've done some extraordinary things by being able to stay awake and alert and use our brains on 2 hours of sleep
or less
in a cold newsroom. And I feel like if you can do that, you can do anything. And so like that's
Okay, Megan gets to ask this
question. You can talk your way out of everything.
Yeah, that too. Yeah.
What am I doing?
This is your favorite question.
My favorite question. I'm sorry, Erin. You didn't
teach it's our first guest. We're still
okay. Lionel, I'm going to share my product first that I've been waiting to share. Erin and I promised. And then you tell me, A, if you've ever used it, and B, if you have a favorite product that you use.
Okay
so Erin and I started using this. Let me turn it right there. Bossia. It is like an oil remover face wash, which will remove any makeup that you ever had on your face. You do this. And then a regular face wash. It is like the bomb.
So is it a wash?
This. Yeah.
It's an like oil. No, you still have to wash.
Yeah. You rub it. Okay. And then you wash your face after. And it will take off like every eyelash, every fake eyelash.
I've never worn eyelashes, but.
It's the bomb, Lionel. I love it. And I started using it when I had to wear that thick makeup for TV. And I've never stopped because it removes everything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Erin?
Oh, my turn?
Yeah.
Yeah, mine is more of a hack. That was a problem.
Like, my face would be breaking out all the time. I've never tried oil.
It's not that I break out all the time too, though. It's not like that.
No, it doesn't clog you up.
Yeah.
Good stuff. Okay,
so no, I'm saying I think that would have been good to use.
Yes. Get off.
I am very greasy. One of our makeup artists called me fried chicken. So my hack is
sanding
seat covers. You know how you get on the toilet?
I remember this. I remember this.
And then it takes it right off. If you don't have oil bladders. Oil bladders are still a little
bit
better. Who
needs oil bladders when you have a toilet behind you?
Yes.
You know, so that's my hack. That wasn't going to be my hack. I do remember Erin doing this, and that was a little odd the first time I was on set and she came back from the bathroom with a toilet seat cover. Like, here, you want a piece?
Does she know what that's really for?
I always wear a white pocket square with my suit. Like, did she just get that from the toilet? Like, this is a little weird. I always wore a white pocket square in my suit, and I often forgot my pocket square. And so I would fold a piece of napkin out the bathroom and put it in, and no one at home would ever know. But like, it's like this crunchy napkin in my suit, which is just so ghetto. Like, if I ever would go somewhere after and forget, they're like, is there like paper towel in there? Anyway, that wasn't my original hack though. This is my favorite product, and Erin has gotten me so much more into being green.
Yes.
From back then, composting and all of that.
Yes.
I make smoothies every day, and I was using red Solo cups every day, and I realized you cannot recycle them and they're terrible to throw away. These are like, this is a Christmas edition, obviously. I've had this for a while, but these are aluminum Solo cups, and there's like a pack that I buy for like $5. You can wash them, so they're infinitely recycled. They're cool for a party. You can write everyone's name on it with a Sharpie. This is not an endorsement, but they can endorse me if they'd like. But also, it keeps your drinks cold. So like your coffee or your smoothie or ice cream, it's like, it's lovely. Like my coffee this whole time, she has a little chill still. And we've been talking for 30 minutes.
My green heart is warmed by this, Lionel.
So loved it.
Erin, I was like not the biggest recycler back then, which is terrible. Like I did it, but I wasn't as anal. But like I then became vegan, and like now everything I want, like compostable, reusable, even like my clothes, I'm getting weird even about like buying like leather sneakers. I'm like, those need to be recycled. So I'm glad that you put me on this journey, and I'm glad that everyone else is catching up now, because we need to save the planet.
Yeah, I know. Aaron's been doing it for years.
Very, you know,
I know. Isn't it? I'm very Mother strident Earth, about certain things. So
she's been doing her job. She was like, why are you buying almond milk? I make it.
I make my kombucha. I make my deodorant. All the things.
That's true. All the things. We can talk about that some other time. Yeah, I think, you guys, we have covered so much. Lionel, you are a beautiful person. I miss waking up with you. Yeah.
I miss you guys too.
I think Lionel has a terrible internet connection right now.
On air with anyone else but you guys.
Yes.
My internet is terrible, which is why in the beginning you guys had to stall. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
We did it. I was
like, where'd he go?
We know how to stall, Lionel. And Erin, do you want to put Lionel on task for 15, 20 seconds just to see if he can do it?
Just to give him a topic and tell him to go?
That's right. Let's see.
Okay, let me get my stopwatch out. Megan, you can pick the topic.
All right, Lionel, I want you to talk about, this is an easy one, the weather where you are today. Give us a quick little forecast.
So we're going to give you 30 seconds and go.
All right, I am in Uptown New York right now. You can see outside. Well, you can't see it, but it is a beautifully hot day. I would say that the wind is not blowing too much because the leaves are very still at this time. My AC is blowing full blast. Beautiful though, I went out for a run. Megan often would talk about these in her weather forecast. If you wanna go ride your bike or something like that, but make sure maybe you pack some of those toilet things to blot you up, because you might be a little greasy after going outside.
Yay!
How's that for
Yes, Lionel. And I love how Erin was giving you times and he literally wrapped it up at the right time, didn't he?
Yeah.
I'm that's another skill. Yeah. I'm used to this.
In brain clocks we have.
Well, congratulations on this new show. This is amazing. Yes, thank you for even, I know I'm like taking control. Thank you for having me on here, but like this is so needed. There's so much in the business that we just don't talk about. And This is such a tight-knit business. We all cross paths, and I just think you guys are the best people to be taking us on this journey. So just thank you for having me.
Okay.
Thank you, Lionel.
We don't go anywhere, Lionel. We're just going to end the broadcast. We want to encourage everybody to please like and subscribe. We very much appreciate it. We love the comments. And thank you so much for watching me and Megan and Lionel. Bye, everybody.